Yeah, and so we'll be back at this space specifically with the sales development forum two more times this year, which will be wonderful. So, and that's enough about me and sponsorship. I do want to give LeeAnn as much time as we possibly can. So LeeAnn is here with LifeLabs New York, and she'll give a much better description of exactly what they do. But she has a PhD in cognitive psychology, and I actually found out about them because I attended a different meetup that was all around the recruitment space, because that was the company I used to work in, a recruiting company. And I found the event incredibly interesting and very actionable and helpful, and I was so excited to get them to come and speak to our community. And so they offer their time, and they do also events with companies as well. So if this is something that you could see yourself rolling out within your organization, that's also an opportunity. So feel free to chat with LeeAnn, or if you have questions about it, feel free to come to me, and I'm happy to pass you along to her. But with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over.
Sounds good. Great. So you guys, this is old school, you're going to need a pen. So if you need a pen, raise your hand. We've got some over here. Hopefully a lot of pens. Yeah, you need a worksheet. So if you don't have a worksheet, that's the second thing to raise your hand for. Maybe I'll pass them on the worksheets.
Yes, and then I'll pass out pens as well.
Great.
There were some pens in one of those rooms, actually.
You need a worksheet. Raise your hands for our worksheets.
And if you need a pen, raise your hand. There's still some, less hands than there were before.
Okay, I'll keep us rolling. So while you're waiting for pens. This is really crazy.
It sounds like great. And can you hear LeeAnn in the back? No.
All right, so I'm going to try and talk louder. How's this? Thumbs up? Louder? All right, so I'll have to ask for a favor from you all to just like really keep it quiet because, I'm not very tall. Should have worn colored shoes, but hopefully you can hear me. So the idea for today is this is really set up as a lab. It's got a title of Influence Hacks, and the keyword being hacks, because I want to share with you tiny, tiny things that you could do that are going to make a big difference in the way you're going about your conversations, so you can gain more buy-in, commitment, action faster. But there's a really important piece I want to mention, and that's actually in the name Life Labs, because the way I go about this is not your traditional way. So you guys have all probably been to so many different sales workshops in the past. This is not a sales workshop. This is a life skills workshop on how to increase influence. So what we've been doing is noticing that there are certain skills that you can really learn within a sales context, or there are skills that you can get into your blood and bones that just always happen. So those are the kind of skills that I'm really interested in. So today, that's going to be life skills, and then you can translate it, like put like your Babelfish on, and translate it into how to pull this into the sales context. I think that's going to be interesting for you all to chat with each other about, like, okay, how do I apply that principle within your work context? So that's the background. Cognitive psychology is my background. I'm particularly interested in how ideas transfer from one person to another, which is basically your job. Like, you guys are craftsmen in transferring of ideas. And so what I want to share with you is a few things, but I want to start with getting your brain thinking about this. So the first question is, let's think like a scientist. And I want you to get in the habit of always defining words really, really clearly, because part of the skills you're going to hear later are getting to the bottom of what a word means. Okay, so if you think about someone you know who has great influence skills, I'm going to underline the word influence, what are they doing differently behaviorally? Okay, because you might say things like, well, they're confident. Well, that's not useful to say that. You'd always be asking yourself, yeah, but what am I seeing behavior that tells me that they're confident? What are they doing with their body, with their intonation, with their pausing, all of those things, right? So let's get into the habit of thinking about that. What I'll have you do is just in a moment turning to your neighbor, just for a brief moment sharing who comes to mind and what behaviors you're seeing them doing. The only thing is it's going to be hard for me to gather you guys back together, so I'm just going to employ like one of those like school tricks where the teacher raises their hand and then you raise your hand. So would you guys mind raise it up? If you see me raising my hand, you raise your hand. And that's the cue that we're coming back together again. So if you're seeing other people raising your hand, you'll be like, oh, okay, coming back together. All right, so that's the easiest way. So turn to your neighbor, sharing who's coming to mind and what are they doing differently? What's the behaviors you can observe and see? Come up to competence, and there's a versus I said in there. Okay, so warmth versus confidence, because usually what happens, the moment that you get perceived as warm, confidence starts, competence goes down. The moment you start being seen as being very competent, warmth starts going down. And very rarely can people actually master both of those, keep them both very, very high. That's not what this workshop is about today. But if you're interested in those topics, we can talk more about it. That's more your nonverbals, your delivery skills, which include things like smiling. It includes things like the way that you're actually using the space and so on. But you see what we're doing right now, we're starting to name some behaviors. What I want to share with you here, I'm going to share with you the five hacks. They're not going to surprise you. Every one of them, you're like, yeah, cool, got that, right? But the interesting piece is what happens when you go about each behavior like a scientist would, and you embed it into your body and you become that thing. It's natural. You do it when you're talking with your mother-in-law. You do it when you're talking, this is just a thing you're always doing at all times. Okay, so that's my goal here for you today. Very, very easy things. So here they are, five things, and you've alluded to some of these already. Stepping into a questions mode, which is what sales folks are amazing at, right? But this is an everyday life, a questions mode. Click on split tracks, I'll explain. Pivot is what it seems. Story and extracting learning. So I'm gonna go for each one of these. I'm gonna do it really, really fast because I don't have much time with you guys, but I wanna make sure you get a chance to actually play with some of these here in this room today. Okay, so
are you
gonna
send out this PowerPoint?
Yeah, it's a very good question. What you're gonna be getting from me is all the key slides plus some exercises to try. So you can take notes because it's good for your brain, but you don't need to. You don't have to write really fast, it's coming. Great, okay, so I'm gonna dive into each one of these. This is meant to be interactive, so if you have questions, like at any point you can raise, I'm not going to wait to the end and be like, what questions do you have? Like, ironically, you can stay in questions mode the entire time, just like shouting out as we go. If it's not relevant to the topic, I'll be like, cool, let's talk about that offline together, and I can, after the session's over, you can talk more about it. Okay, so, I'm going to dive into the first one here, questions mode, and so I have a question for you. You've been recruited, let's say, to join the LifeLabs research team. We're an active team of researchers, and now we've noticed from that group of people, so anybody back here where I was showing you, these are actual pictures here from the group. If you've been named as someone who's a great influencer, someone who gets stuff done really, really well, and you're in our lab, you're sitting there, and we're actually analyzing what are you doing differently, and one thing we're noticing is, wow, there's something different about the questions that are being asked here. So my question to you is, how are you going to measure that? You got an instinct that there's something different about those questions. What are some things you could measure?
How open-ended the question is,
how
the person can talk more.
Nice, open versus closed, and you're also mentioning, are they talking more? We do word count on the other person's, how quick do they respond, and what the word count of it is. What else?
How you present the question within the context of what was previously said.
Yeah, transition statements, like hooks and weaves from the context. Nice. That's all behavioral, right? On the simplest level, so all those things are right, we can go on and on, right? But on the simplest level, you can actually just simply count the amount of questions that are being asked. And that's the thing that really floored us. When we actually sat down, we're like, let's just count them. And what we saw, average 15-minute conversation, so average folks, right? We just go right now into the streets of New York City and listen to two random people talking. How many questions do you think get asked in a 15-minute period by one person? Just shout out your numbers.
45.
45.
Six.
Two. Try not. Where is it? 45. What are we doing?
It's fine. You have to talk really fast.
It is New York.
Nice. Yeah, so we're seeing an average of two, right? And it's 15 minutes. You can imagine, like, and there's standard questions like, how's it going, right? So there's a kind of standard, right? Now we look at the people who've been named as the great influencers or great motivators, whatever keyword we want to use there, then in our labs, and we're noticing like, oh, that's a very different kind of conversation because 10 are being asked it. Now usually at this point I have someone say, wait, aren't they annoying? Isn't that sound like an interrogation? And you might think so, but it doesn't sound like that. Basically, it actually messes up the data because it starts shifting the way the other person talks as well. So they start asking questions too, so we get kind of unclean data. But what's interesting is that it really quickly elevates from small talk into something much, much more interesting for everyone in those conversations. So on the simplest level, one of the easiest missions you could have, ask one more question than normal, and this is in everyday life. So you have to be asking yourself, I get it, you're on a call with somebody, you've got a script you're used to, it's like, it's in your blood, you go through your script. But what happens when in everyday life you're able to just stay in that kind of questions mode? Suddenly you can start shifting the quality of those questions. So there's one piece, and that's one of the missions I'm going to be emailing to you guys after. Well, you guys will be emailing afterwards. But the second piece here is, I want you to always be reacting, particularly when you're triggered. So when you're bothered by somebody, when someone's being annoying, you stay in questions mode. And this is in everyday life. Go back to the mother-in-law concept. Right? Or back to think about girlfriend, boyfriend, whoever, niece, nephew. You stay in that questions mode. So as your manager, you come up with a really good idea, you think. Your manager is saying this back to you. What questions are coming to mind? Let's just...
Why?
We can do a why. What else?
When?
When's a better time? What else?
What is the top priority?
Yeah, there we go. You see, we're starting to shift in different question categories. Now, your brain has like a fingerprint for the type of question you always go to. Like a lot of you yelled out why, right? So you're trying to get to the reason behind it. I like whys. But what happens when that doesn't really work? The person's sort of like, ah, oh, it's too complicated to explain. You have to be able to pivot into a different category of questions. Okay, but the most important thing is that your first instinct is to not start defending your idea. That is pure loss. There's no influence power in advocating for the idea. We have to go into inquiry before advocacy. So if we decide right then to say, wait, I think it's actually a top priority because X, Y, Z, lost. And we notice that very, very quickly in our research. The people who stay in inquiry mode for a little bit before advocating, they had much, much, much more power. Okay, so that's something you have to train in everyday life, this thing called Q-stepping. So question mode is default mode. The way I personally practice it, like I'm sitting in the subway, kind of bored, there's nothing really to do, and I'll just ask myself, what's something mean someone could say to me right now? Like something where I'd be kind of offended, right? And I'd feel the urge to kind of defend myself. And I practice actually in my mind, okay, well, how could I stay in curiosity mode? Like get to curious and find a way to stay in questions mode there. Okay, now, this something here is going to be a bit weird, but I think it's important. I want you to figure out where your curiosity is in your body. Okay, this is kinesthetic learning, so we'll do this right now. If you just stand up for a moment and touch where you feel your curiosity. So if you feel it as an emotion, touch on your body where you feel it, and you can turn around and take a look at this room. It's kind of interesting to see the varieties. Turn around and take a look at this room's curiosity. We got heads, we got stomachs, we got hearts, we got temples. All right, you can take a seat again. I just wanted to stand up. So the concept is, you're on a call, you're in general, it's like something's not working well. Whatever you just touched, that's your activation spot. So for me, it's here. Just for, there's no right or wrong place, but for me, it's here. So if I'm having some challenges, let's just say with my husband, for me, it's like superpowers activated. And so the curiosity shield comes up, and I'm like, all right, I'm in questions mode. Unfortunately, by now, he started to notice that I'm doing it. So he was always like, why are you always touching your stomach when you're talking? So you got to figure out what your thing is. But it's really getting yourself in a space of curiosity. Okay, so that's the first thing, staying in a queue, in basically Q-stepping before advocating. Sounds simple, hard to do. You're going to get some exercises from me emailed. All right, I'm going to move us on. These all start to link up a little bit. The second thing I want to share with you is what was mentioned earlier, being a very attentive listener. Now, most people say, yeah, it's easy to be a good listener, but actually it's not. We've never been trained how to be good listeners. The biggest signal-setting action to be perceived as a good listener is doing playbacks or split tracks. We've seen that very, very quickly from our research. Okay, so it's a signal setting action. People will perceive you as a good listener if you do these things. Now, what is a playback and split track? Playback is just what you imagine it to be. You're playing back what they said. Now, it doesn't have to be a parrot. Like, I'm not saying take their word for word. Just grab a keyword they use and weave it forward. Okay, so you can just repeat one of the words they said and weave it before you say your next thing. Be like, oh yeah, okay, return on investment, sure, blah, 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 right? So you're just repeating what they said. Now that's kind of standard. You guys are probably like, yeah, got it. But I tell you, when we listen in on calls, very rarely do people actually do this. Okay, so my suggestion would be for you to track yourself for a day and see how many playbacks you actually do cognitively, so you're aware of it. Did one, did one, did one. Okay, now level two of this is what we call a split track. So this is kind of simple, but a split track is noticing when people confound their variables. They look like they're talking about one thing, but actually what's happening as if saying two things, or three things even. And so this is happening all the time, and this is another really fun subway experiment. For me, I'm sitting there, I have my earplugs in, I have no music playing, I'm just eavesdropping. And what I'm doing is I'm like, whoa, this person's actually saying six things in that one sentence, right? So I'm just trying to listen on different levels. Okay, and a split track will be being able to pull that apart and be like, okay, I'm hearing a few things, X and Y. And then whatever question comes next, that's whatever is needed, right? So which should we focus on first? Whatever you think is most useful there. Now, what I want to do is take a look at, hopefully you all can see that. Take a look at that. Okay, now, you're going to those meetings on Friday. So, here's the thing. For the brain, that's a lot of cognitive load. And it's very easy to miss it and just pick up on one of them. Right? So when you ask your questions, when you say questions mode, before you do that, you probably have to place hold and say, oh, okay, wait, so I'm hearing, and how many issues you guys see in there? Could be three, could be four, there could be many more underneath it all, right? So you have to place hold and be like, okay, so I'm hearing three issues. Let me just ask you first about the first thing here. When you said confused, what is the thing you're confused about? And then later come and be like, okay, you said you think you can manage it, what can you commit to that about, right? So there's a lot of stuff you can grab onto here. I want you to practice it. The way we're gonna practice it is, it might be a little bit chaotic, but ideally it's in groups of two. If you can't find one for that, it doesn't match up, okay, you can just simply join as a listener to a group, one of the other groups, but ideally try and find a group of two, meaning that you can move around, okay? Person number one, actually, let's do this. I'll have you pairing up right now before I tell you the instructions. So just in silence, try and just point to someone. And if you raise your hand if you don't have somebody, we'll have some helpers if you don't mind. Okay, so raise your hand if on it, you'd be like, yeah, got it, right? That's it. And then I'm going to I'll be the timer. There's one more question in the back. It's on him.
I was going to say, could you maybe do some split tracking for us with someone random?
So you can see it in action? Yeah, I'm going to let you guys do it on your own first. And then we'll do so, okay, let's do this. I'm going to write now. I'll just do it. I'll do the top of you guys. What was up for me? Okay? So the whole group can split track me. True story. So I'm the CEO of LifeLabs. LifeLabs does a whole bunch of training, and we have a whole bunch of facilitators. We're active with all kinds of tech companies. It's a really exciting role. It's also a hard role because I love facilitating. I don't love running a company. The thing that I do love, though, is I love creating stuff. I'm like a dreamer. And as you can imagine, thinking about the people in your life who are dreamers, that's sometimes hard for my employees because they're like, oh my god, the next new thing, right? So I'm constantly trying to reel myself in. The thing I do get to vent with, though, is LifeLabs has something called the LifeLabs House that we bought in upstate New York. Beautiful, massive farmland and farm house that people come to do retreats and things like this. And so I get to decorate it. And I'm not a professional decorator, but it's been really, really fun trying to think about ways. It's also been really stressful because all these things create lots of different tension points for me with my employees and with me trying to get stuff done. So busy. All right, well, if you try right now to figure out the two major buckets I'm talking about, what would they be?
So I hear a few things. Uh-huh. You're the CEO of Black Labs, and you're trying to get a few things done. Uh-huh. The first and the last sentence.
It's hard for you to be a CEO because CEO is systematic and you're creative.
There we go. Uh-huh.
That's it. It's an entrepreneurial curse.
It's a curse, right? Yeah. So there we go. So we can. There's many different. There's nothing right or wrong about how you would do this, right? But one thing is you could focus in on like, wow, you like to be a dreamer, but you are forced into systems. That's probably the same thing with your house as well as with your work, right? So we could pull those two buckets. What's another way we could have split tracked it?
I would have said you're very busy and you're very passionate.
Yeah, there we go, that too, right? So, and the goal here would be we want to use a few key words that I've said to make sure I feel really heard. So, you're very passionate about things like your work and your house, and you're very busy with things like all these employees and so and so, right? So that's the way of split tracking it. Okay, does that help you?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. So we're gonna do this. I'm timekeeper. I'm gonna use the hand signal. Okay. Person number one, you know you're ready. Let loose. 1 minute. Go. So he's asking, like, should you split track it in a way that actually is going to be useful for you? skills, right? And I think, yes, very much. Now, the hard part, though, is because your brain has a certain track, it's used to that same track, it might be that it doesn't really resonate for the other person. And the goal of all of us is that they feel really heard, right? So I would try and notice energy spikes. So that's a little bit, that's, I can't really quantify that, but you notice when someone's talking like a bit, like, I don't know, I said the LifeLabs house. And it's like, wow, you see the energy go up, right? Or like, dreamer, like the word dreamer, or you like. So you can notice their energy spikes, and that's when I decide maybe I'll pivot towards them a little bit more than what I would have gone for. But play with it. Yeah, it's a good question. Okay, we're going to rotate now. The person goes 1 minute long. Ready, set, go. What's up for you? So it's hard to like make sure you're asking good questions in written email because we have the asynchronous bit of it. But for me, I'm still in questions mode. So even as I get into what I'm writing my email, I'll be like, okay, what's the most important thing? I'm asking myself questions. What's my gist here? What's the most important thing I want to be saying? okay, what's my lead? What's the call to action? So I stay in questions mode internally, but then also I might say to them, like, what are questions they're going to be asking right now? And that actually, so that leads into this pivoting. So you're pivoting into perspective using your question mode. These other ones I'm going to share with you, they actually go quite quickly. These are the foundational skills that lead you to do these things better. Okay, so I've got 15 more minutes. I'm going to share these things with you, and these other ones are going to go faster. Okay, so pivoting. The idea is, okay, we want to find their sight lines. We want to understand how are they seeing the world. Right now, you're all sitting in a very particular way where you're noticing me, but if I have you shift just the tiniest bit to your left, let's do it right now in your chair. Now, notice something you haven't yet noticed in this room.
That is a cool
plan. That's a cool plan. Right. So that's cheesy. You can turn back now. I know it's a bit cheesy what I'm having you do, but sometimes these simple things are really, really important to get us out of our old habits. And if we really want to have influence, we have to do that. We just shift a little bit. I'm not saying like entirely shift perspective like this. Get a little bit out of your own sight line to see their sight lines. Now, with that, we've noticed that people who are high in influence, we ask them, what are you doing? And basically what we called it, they didn't call it this, but we called it their big pivot charts in their head. And they're doing things like this. They were asking themselves a set of questions. And each one of them had their own fingerprint on how they asked those questions, but they were regularly doing it. Okay, so you might, if you're coming from a working member or you're a manager, you want to be, of course, asking yourself always these kind of questions about your manager. Biggest challenge right now, what's exciting him or her the most? What does he or she dislike the most? Look at this one. What keywords or phrases are they using a lot? Okay, so this is my standard set of questions I'm asking myself regularly. Even when I'm setting up, let's say, a workshop with somebody, and I'm on the phone with them setting up this workshop, like here I'm doing today, I'm still going to try and go through and be like, okay, what's the audience's biggest challenge right now? What's most exciting to them? And so on. So I just have this set of questions always in my head. Okay, I'm going to just give you a moment to think about either your manager or someone you work with regularly. Let's not go for customer, because I want you to stick actually in the perspective of not sales right now. And just jotting down the backside somewhere, at least like just quickly some answers to this. You're not going to share it, but I want you to just try it for a moment, and then we'll come back together. So filling in for your manager or someone you work with closely. You just jot down 1, 2, 3, 4, and what your answers would be for each one of them. Keywords. So I'm going to show you right here. I don't want to get into politics at all, you guys. But I want to share with you, this started at Yale, this research, and it started because of this guy. Nowadays, I could use a lot of other examples, but I'm just going to stick with old school stuff so we don't get into new stuff. But what I started noticing is, like, he particularly was very, very good at finding the keywords, the code words, they called it, of the audience. And I'm going to share with you in a moment a sentence he said. It was I forgot the name of the conference, but it was a very religious group. He was speaking at a conference for them. And what he said is written here word for word, and he got a standing ovation from what he said. Okay, so here's what it is. People stood up and were like, yes, right? So the concept here is, basically his team, and not even him, they just knew the word, the one word that's going to get this excitement. Now you guys heard me when I talked about a dreamer, the word dreamer gets me really excited. For you, you might be like, I hate dreamers, right? But I'm like, dreamers! So you got to find those words that matter. And so what that means is listening through, and what I can tell you is, you can listen on different levels, one of which, very, very interesting, is I see what you're saying compared to I hear what you're saying compared to I get what you're saying. All the same meaning, but they reveal to you the sense that the person is using. That's like NLP, if you guys have read some of those books, neuro-linguistic programming is all about that. But that's something really interesting tomorrow, just to listen through. What sense is the person speaking in? So for me, I'm very kinesthetic, so I need to like really move ideas around, and so I'm always talking about, I'm not grasping that, I'm not getting it, right? If my team comes to me with an idea, and they're like, hey, can I tell you about some of the things that are on my mind, that's not gonna grab me. I can't even stop talking it. I can't even do it, stop doing it. It's not gonna be able to excite me as much as if they can speak about it in a kinesthetic way. Okay, so just listening for those code words is something really important. So basically all he said there was this. What he said didn't matter. He said something underneath it, and that goes to warmth and confidence, as I was saying earlier. So with that, what happens, the only way you can find this out is you have to get your brain in the habit of going on listening tours. Figuring out who are key stakeholders who I have not spoken with in a little while, and I'm not just listening to see, oh, can I sell them on something, but actually it's like, hey, what are their keywords? What's up for them right now? And listening through, basically. What that leads you to is this, I'm going to call this bonus, because this is not a workshop on persuasion, but what it does do is it lets you be more persuasive. So what's in your hands right now is just extra stuff I'm not covering today. You can look at it later, but the only way you can fill that stuff out, like you're seeing a benefit statement, the urgency statement, the only way you would know those things is through doing listening tours with each person. Okay, so this is a sheet I would suggest you should do, you fill out whenever you want to persuade somebody for something. But true persuasion comes from creating win-win situations, and that's going to be coming from these habits, basically. Okay, so that's the pivoting idea, getting into the habit of creating pivot charts. Key points we've covered so far, do playbacks, make people feel seen and heard. Add structure, and then finally, pause regularly to pivot into that perspective. The last two things I want to cover, just very briefly, are dropping into story. We notice that very, very clearly with people who are named as great influencers, you almost couldn't stop them from dropping into a story mode. It's like they parachuted straight into a story mode whenever we talk with them. We're trying to investigate what they're doing. We'd be like, hey, Kate, before you move on, what did you just do right there cognitively when you were preparing for that answer? And they wouldn't just answer. They'd be like, well, let me just share with you, actually, another story about that. And I'd be like, nicely, what's going on, it wasn't an irrelevant story, so it was just so fascinating, right? But when you're a scientist and you just want the facts, you're like, oh, stop being in story mode. So we went a little meta with them there. What I can share with you, though, if you look at our evolutionary history, for many, many years, we didn't have printing. We didn't have written words. What we had was story. That's how culture evolved, through story, for most of our evolutionary history. So if someone says to you the words, let me share a story with you, you cannot help but be interested. There's a P300 way that goes through the brain and will actively attune you back into paying attention to that. The word, even the word story, grabs people. I had an interesting moment. I was on a panel, and you can imagine, like, there's this panel of people sitting up here. There's the moderator. I'm like in the middle of this, and it was a panel on customer delight. And so I'm talking about delight from a neurological perspective. And there are questions being asked for the audience, things like, okay, well, you know, what's your advice? What's the easiest thing we can do to increase delight? Okay, so people are giving their answers. And what I noticed, so I'm like the last one to go, and there's this one guy here, Didier is his name, and every single time he speaks, everybody, I can literally see it in the room, they shift forward. Like, if you can imagine, like, you're picturing a whole audience of people kind of just like pivoting forward in their seats, they're like hanging on to every word. So I'm supposed to be preparing my answer, but I can't even, because I'm sort of like, what the heck is he doing that's getting everybody to listen, right? And so what I noticed is he never actually gives the advice straight up. He always embedded it in a story. So if you ask him the question, how should we increase customer delight? He'd be like, well, okay, I had this insight once when I was working with Sony Music. Blah, 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 right? So it's not name dropping, but actually, of course, it helps because you can name drop. But what he did is he just activated the brain circuitry. And if you look at, there's tons of research around this, that the brain literally gets into resonance with the speaker the moment they drop into a story mode. So that's a very easy influence tool for you guys. If you want to create rapport and synchronicity, what you would be doing is you would just simply be able to pull into a story mode. I was trying to demo it. I don't know if it was obvious or not. It was kind of obvious probably, but yeah. So the idea here is, like, instead of just telling, try and do it in story format. So what does that mean for you? You have to have a story bank. Each one of you has to put the time in, particularly if I pull it back to a sales context. You have to know what the greatest obstacle is that you hear from your clients, from your manager, from your colleagues, from your family. What are the obstacles you hear? And then you have to be able to plug in a story. Because otherwise, those stories take too long. And that's the worst. When you get a storyteller, it takes too long. That is the worst. Okay? So you've got to be short and concise with your stories, and that means you've got to take the time to develop them. But I want you to have if-thens in your head. So, like, if somebody says this thing, then I can plug in that story. So great influencers, they do that legwork. They put in those, they know their story bank. So if you take a moment right now, just pause, you're not going to share this, but what are some obstacles you commonly hear in your everyday work world, and what story could you share? I'll just give you a moment just so you're processing this stuff, to jot that down. Some ideas of your obstacles and some stories you could be sharing. Let's pause and think about it. Anybody willing to share a story with us? Anybody willing to share a short story of an obstacle that you face? It could be in everyday life, it could be with a client or a customer, and how you overcame it. Nice, thank you.
I sell prices to restaurants. Huh. So price is always the or whatever. So I guess the story I could tell is I was a line cook at a restaurant that went bankrupt. And so, like, having had that experience, I know how important finances and responsible finances are for restaurants, but I also know that food costs are very rarely what actually makes a restaurant go bankrupt. That's really how restaurants are really wasting money. So,
yeah.
Pivot that into spend more money on places.
Of course. So nice, great. Right, because first of all, that makes you be on the same level, but also it puts it into a story format. Do you guys feel it? I don't know if literally there's this moment where your brain pulls. You're like, you can even hear it here. It got really, really quiet in that moment. The moment he started, he was like, I used to be in a restaurant. Like, everybody was like, oh. Like, you can't help it. It's just like, it's so weird. It's like a magnet, right? So I just wanted you to feel that, the power of story there. Okay, and so I'm almost out of time here. There's one more thing I want to cover, and then I'll actually open the floor for maybe 2 minutes of questions, if that's okay. And then I'll do my wrap. The other thing I want to share here, so building a story bank is really, really important. Now, this last one is just a sentence I want to share with you, and it's exactly what you're seeing here. But if you think about, we're LifeLabs, so I'm totally into, like, chemistry and distillation and stuff like that. So if you picture, this is your everyday work world, right? As life is going on. But we're busy and we're like heads down, we're doing stuff. We very rarely take a moment and just like distill out and extract out what's the most important bits. What can I learn from this? And so when we start looking at people who are high in influence, they have that habit. They get off a call and they're like, cool, I learned some stuff, but what can I learn about my process? So that pause habit, asking yourself, what's my process? And tied to that is being a relentless feedback seeker. Now, sometimes that's a bit hard because like asking your customers, like, you know, what could I have done better? It feels a little bit weird sometimes. But my suggestion would be that you're regularly asking everybody in your life, sort of like, hey, one thing I want to do is I want to be constantly improving. So what's one thing you think I'm doing really, really well? And what's one thing you think that could be 10% better? And I'm phrasing that in a very particular way. What's one thing that could be 10% better will give you a lot of responses compared to what's something I could be doing better. The number 10% gets people talking. Because they're like, oh, 10%. Then they'll name something that's like 100%. Right? But still, you're like, you gotta give them permission. 10%, they're like, there's always 10%, right? So being a relentless feedback seeker, and then each day being like, pause, before I leave this space. Like for me, it's actually the entryway to my building. So when I'm going home, I mean, I love experiments. This is my thing. So I do lots of this stuff on the subway and so on, just entertain myself. But still, I've created like a gateway. As I walk in the entryway to my apartment, I'll ask myself, okay, what's one thing I learned today? What can I keep? What can I move forward with? And so as the elevator is riding me up to my, I'm thinking about that. Okay, so the idea is pausing regularly to extract the learning. All right, so I'm going to actually pause here. Any questions you all have? And then I'll do my final wrap here with what's your takeaways.
We have like 5 minutes for questions at least. Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah, what do you listen to? Like, do you have any podcasts that you recommend? I mean, this is great. This stuff is great. I just want to continue the self-learning.
So I'm not an auditory processor. I can't do it. So it doesn't mean there aren't good podcasts out there, but I'm a reader, and I'm actually like a very active, like write things down and move things around.
Where can I get more of this?
Yeah, okay. So what I'll do is I'm gonna give a list of recommended books. For persuasion stuff, Cialdini stuff is just amazing. And then in general, there's a lot of stuff around, like one of my favorite books is called A More Beautiful Question. Another favorite book is Insight Selling. Probably a lot of you read that one, but that's just like good for life, like insight-based selling. But what I'll do is I'm going to give some recommendations, like my favorite books, to you guys as well. I'll also give you my email address in case you have any questions. You can just email me, like, what else? I'm happy to share. Yeah?
Based on your need to balance being a founder as well as being a practitioner, what are you doing on a daily basis to overcome that and get to like whatever next level it is for you?
Okay, he's asking me very personal questions, which is lovely. So, because I mean, the thing is, all of us have this. Basically, we need to be sustainable for the long haul. So, for me, the main things that I do is I ask myself, what's my MIT each day? Most important thing. So in the morning, I'll be like, what's my MIT? And I'm only ever allowed to have 3 things that I have to get done that day. Even though I probably have like 200 things I have to get done, but if those 3 things get done, I feel a sense of accomplishment. And so that's just for me a feeling of progress, and then that extracting the learning as I get in the elevator, that gives me that feeling. I have to constantly fight my brain's urge to just constantly want more and more and more and more. And so I have accountability partners with that. So the co-founder of LifeLabs, she's constantly being like, wait. And I balance her out. So it's also, I guess, finding people who can help you recognize when you're falling into your typical problems. These 5 things that I share with you, I ask people to hold me accountable to them. So when I'm, for example, doing a workshop, is I didn't know how to add a story in. Usually I have someone in the back of the room, and part of my team will be like, you know, like, oh, I got a story, right? So I'm constantly trying to like do deliberate practice for my brain. Yeah, maybe we can take that to more questions.
When it comes to asking questions, I find that sometimes you don't get the full answer the first time you ask them. So there's an inclination to want to keep probing.
Yeah.
But I wonder that. Are you polluting the answer by potentially injecting what you think you want to hear? Like, from a brain science perspective, what's the approach to it?
Right, okay, so 2 things come to mind. See what I just did? I don't know what I'm going to say. Literally, I'm just making this up. But I always just say that. So there are 2 things. This is really meta. So one thing is, people need good transition statements. If you just start asking random questions and they don't feel like they're connecting, they get suspicious. And then you start getting stuff like this where they're like, well, I don't know, right? So you'll need to be able to ask your first question and be like, oh, you know what you said just makes me curious about that. Can I ask you a different question on the same topic, right? And so you have to kind of build a transition statement in between. And second of all, double touching is a technical term for this. So you actually stick with that question. It's a very good technique. And one of the favorite questions I would like to ask is floor questions. Remember earlier when I said, what's influence, right? So what I'm constantly doing is like mentally underlining words that could mean something to different people. It's a blurry word. So if you say to me, oh, LeeAnn, we should be more proactive. I want my team to be more proactive, right? And I'd be like, oh, wow, that's interesting, because that word proactive means different things to different people. So I'd be like, what does proactive mean to you? And they might say things, well, you know, like being strategic and in general, not waiting till the last moment, right? Now what I do is I don't pivot into a different question category. I stick with that question and I say, oh, you just mentioned the word strategic. What does strategic mean to you? Do you get it? So I drill down a little bit before it, and at some point you kind of hit bottom there with your blur words, investigating what words mean, then you pivot. What most people do is they pivot too quick. They'll be like, okay, so what have we tried in the past for that thing? That was too quick of a pivot. So my answer, I guess, I would say stick with it, but make sure you have good transitions so they understand why you're asking those questions.
Okay, thank you.
Great.
Because a lot of us in the room spend a lot of time on the phone,
yeah.
What are your thoughts on NLP and how that fits into this body of work? Is that something you should be letting down on?
Yeah.
Just in general.
So from a scientific perspective, that's like super contentious. Neuro-linguistic programming, some people are like, it gets poo-pooed all the time, like it's not scientific, right? I think there's still a lot of value in it, first of all, because it makes you notice stuff that you wouldn't normally be noticing. For me, what I find most interesting is to be listening to the different senses. From a research perspective, that's still kind of messy. Even from our research, we can't get clean data around that. But what it does, it puts me in a different mode of listening. So I'm okay with that. So we actually have people do that to get them to a different space. Even if I don't know the technique actually works, like matching the language the person is using, I don't know if that really works. But what I do know is that it keeps you in a different mode. Yeah, and I think maybe one more question, or are we good?
Yeah, is there any other?
Last question, awesome.
You mentioned something about a conversation, how you say you share a story. And he put it great now that the spice is relatable and he understood the problem. You mentioned one thing that I just have to ask, what the hell is a PS300 that goes through the back?
Yes, okay, so that's my neural psychology coming into play. So the P300 wave is an orientation wave. So if right now something happened, like all these lights went out, in each one of your brains, this P300 wave goes through the brain, and what it does, do you remember on TV there was this thing that would be like, this is an emergency broadcast signal, and it'd be like, beep, right? That's kind of what's happening in the brain. It stops all other things besides like breathing and processing, and it makes you orient. Like you basically, you turn toward wherever you think the problem's coming from. Okay, so a story, weirdly, has the same effect as like a loud bang. The P300 is gonna go through the brain and be like, stop what you're doing, stop what you're thinking about the past, the present, the future, and just literally listen to this story. Now, if the story is not interesting within like 10 seconds, you're back to doing your normal thing. That's the hard part, is okay with that story.
You gotta jump on that story.
Yeah, but you do it for that moment. So, okay.
Thank goodness, because I thought the P300 was a new Chrysler sedan.
It probably could be. I think that's a good name for it. Grab everyone's attention. Yeah, so here's the thing. I'm gonna end here with, now we've come up with five different things. As a quick reminder, we talked about Q-stepping, defaulting into questions mode, playbacks and split tracks, pivoting, meaning using their keywords, doing listening tours. That prep sheet I shared with you might be something to activate you. Dropping a story mode by either creating a story bank as preparation or just practicing each day, like checking off, did I tell a story today? And then making sure you're regularly pausing to extract the learning. What I'd like for you to do is pick one thing right now, and as an accountability partner, basically, or not let me do this, just simply jot somewhere down that one word. Just simply because we know being able to either share it, either written or discussing, and I'm not going to discuss because we'll be too loud and it's hard together and we're back together again, but just jot down a keyword of what you want to try in the week ahead. Just to cement and make today actually be actionable. Extract out that learning. And I'll end here by giving you my email address.
in case you have any questions, in case you want, this is a short version of what we do other trainings like this. If you're looking at your team, let us know. I'm also going to hang around in case you have any additional questions, and I'll pass the baton back over to you as well. Thanks for joining me, guys. Happy influence.